I've been coming to this conference since it first started, and I just want to thank Patrick because this conference is the one where I come to learn. Now, I go to a lot of the other conferences. I go to the other conferences. You've been out to several of those. Can I just, you know, can you give a round of applause for Patrick? He hosts again with a great $6,000, right, for those market forecasts. You know, I'm a forecasting geek, and much to my surprise, when I went to business school, I aced statistics. Now, I was not really good at math in high school. It was terrible. And the statistics classes in colleges are filled with psychology majors, and they're filled with math majors. And I was a business major, right? And I thought, I'm never going to use statistics. And lo and behold, I found out that I actually was good at it. And later in my career, I became a forecaster, working for a manufacturing company. And then I worked for Oracle as a product manager for forecasting. And I worked for SAP as product manager for forecasting solutions and SteelWedge software for forecasting solutions. So I've been around this for a long time. So I know it's hard to think of me as a statistical geek, but does that help the geek. So I look at this stuff, and you know, I make it my job to try to serve the industry and help people understand. Sorry. So let's talk about the hype. The hype started back in 2013, and this is ground zero for the hype, right? And we did an extensive breakdown on this. We looked at this report when it came down. A colleague of mine delved into the numbers, and we looked at it. And you can go out to my website and take a look and see. We've got a thing that we did this breakdown. It's called AUV Aside, Five Reasons Why They Got the Drone Market Forecast Wrong. But yet, today, in a press release, if you go to AUV Aside and see a press release, what do? They quote this forecast. Still today, they quote it, so it's gospel. And it's gospel to everybody else. So yeah, some of the predictions in there were pretty wild, right? One of them was precision agriculture and public safety will make up 90% of the market growth for unmanned aerial systems. And in fact, the opposite is true. Those are the two laggards in the industry, right? So we track this, and like I said, you know, we want to find out what's really working and what's not. Here's a rumor, and Patrick alluded to this today. The rumor was that, you know, FAA consumer drone regulation has put a squash on drone sales, and the industry is tanking. Well, that's both true and false, because some did get a restriction of sales, and it was the local hobby shop. And what our research found was that local hobby shops are becoming less and less a popular place for people to go to drones, to buy drones, because they're a headache for the local drone operators. So people are buying from drone distributors where they're buying online. And I've got research I'll show you on that. But just to verify that, in fact, the sales did, in fact, do well this year, this is the NPD group, and they said, look, it's 150% growth from last year. So that's just holiday sales. Just the holiday sales, and there's a note down there that says it's 5 weeks from Black Friday to Christmas. So drone sales were up, but those are the types of rumors that exist in our industry. And I was trying to find out, was the rumor true? You know, rumors are 75% true, right? You ever heard that statement? Rumors are 75% true. So something true about it. How many of you saw the BARD study on Section 333? Do you know which one I'm talking about? The drones, Center for the Study of Drone at BARD College, they did an analysis of U.S. drone exemptions from 2014 to 2015. So they looked at all the Section 333 exemptions, and they poured over the data. And they did a pretty good job of it, but some of the analysis was a little captain obvious for me. But they did find a wonk, and this is it. And the wonk is that in the beginning, more than half of the applications named only one commercial operation, about 57%. But as time progressed, they noticed that applications had multiple categories and uses listed, and that's the graph here, and that the single intended operations dropped to about 30%. So the blue line on the top there, those are where the applicant listed, I've got three operations that are going to be three different types of operations. And then the yellow line there, that's the four categories. They named four categories. Now there's more, right? They've been trying, since this study stops in December. As it goes forward into the year, these numbers go up, and then there's a category of 5, 6, and 7 that go up. So the interesting thing about this is, and I look at every Section 333 application I go through, every day you look through, I look at the application, I drill down, what are they writing, what are they looking at? I don't look at all the details of it, but I look at the listed operation. Because I want to know what's the market, what are they going to need, and what's the commercial use. And I find that this is the wonk here, and I'm calling it the Heavy Duty Brothers effect. And it comes from the fact that third-party companies, they've advertised low-cost Section 333 services, help you apply, and they've done this for thousands of applicants. So the person who's actually doing aerial photography didn't write their application. They handed it over to a third-party service. They said, we'll get you your Section 333. They put the paperwork through. They get paid for the service. And this is not a legal, these are not legal firms. These are not law firms. These are firms who just offer that service. So when you look into a section, I'm going to quote right now from an operation from Section 333. Barbaro Buffa Inc. I'm sorry, you're not here, right? Okay, good. Barbaro Buffa Inc. had listed, and these are the operations, aerial photography, videography, cinematography for inspections, real estate, filming, agriculture, search and rescue, training to persons individual or belonging to both private and public organizations, special events, mining, and close-set filming. Okay? That's on the application, right? Granted. Application granted. The next application in line, about 3 or 4 or 5 down, flying circus pictures. What did they list? Aerial photography, videography, cinematography for inspections, real estate, filming, agriculture, search and rescue, training for peoples, persons individually belonging to both private and public organizations, special events, mining, close-up filming. There you go. Okay? What's wrong with that picture? Well, what's wrong with the picture is, oh, and here's the other thing, sorry. This is the other thing that's a little bit of a wonk here. They list their aircraft, right? The aircraft that they're going to use. And so, if one has a DJI-inspired one, they put another one. Now, I actually have a reason why you do that, because you don't want to have to go back and apply for aircraft that you might use. But you've seen the news that companies have applied for 500, 600, 1,000 different types of aircraft that are listed on their application. They don't open those. They never will open those. But it prevents them, because it's just the regulatory issue, right? It's the law. All right. Let me drill down a little bit. This wonk then creates a problem when you begin to look at what commercial aircraft are operating commercially in the United States. And people look to these applications and they go, well, the BART study says on average exemptions listing 2 unmanned aircraft types that will be used in operations. The most popular unmanned aircraft maker is DJI, which accounts for 2 out of 3 drones listed in all its exemptions. What does that mean? Does it mean that DJI has a 70% market share, right, of commercial aircraft in the U.S.? Anybody? You would? No. It just means, absolutely not. It's not even market share. It just means that this is the sum of what is listed in the applications. And again, it's what they might use. Not even what they actually own, or not even actually what they will use. So, Barbara gives us this great breakdown and says, here's commercial use. Here's the industries that are going to, we think, where operations are going to occur. And you look at these two pie charts, they're different, aren't they? The one on the left is multiple categories. In other words, they listed multiple categories. And right away, what's the problem with that? Does anybody see the problem with that? Anybody with statistics in here? If I listed multiple categories, how could I get a chart that equals 100%? You can't. It wouldn't ever be 100%. Only the one on that side would be 100%, because I only listed one category, and so then you have a percentage breakdown, right? But there it is, and it says what film, photo, and video. And real estate, they're sort of the same. You can kind of get an idea of what are the biggest industry and what's the biggest industry for commercial UAS. It's film, photo, and video. It's not agriculture, it's not public safety, first responders, sorry. This one says construction, this one says utilities, energy, and infrastructure. This one says agriculture, big. That's because people were putting out, they were getting marked with that agriculture or mining or something else. So, I kind of go, you know what, it's a wonk. I can't get any data here. This tells me nothing about the industry. So, we do things a different way at SkyLogic Research. We do user surveys. We go out, we ask people, what are you doing? What to buy? What are you using for? What you paid for it? What's your intended use? What's your operation? Sorry, 5 minutes here. Okay, I'm going to go through these real quick. This is the latest survey. Buyers are pretty much evenly split between Gen X and baby boomers. So I was real happy to find this, that yes, it is a country for old men. Price points. Most drones purchased, regardless of what it's used for, occur somewhere between $1,000 and $2,000. So more than half of all buyers purchase drones between $1,000 and $4,000. Okay, well that tells us a little bit. So it's interesting data. The most popular brands. Well, turns out DJI really is the most popular brand, but their market share is not 70%, it's about 50%. And this is North America. This is the entire world. If you went around the world, then it might be different, and maybe even a little bit lower, because in Europe, you've had brands that have been there longer than they have, and Paris has been there longer than they have, and in China, you've got hundreds of brands, especially at the lower price points. But still, people are willing to buy. So you got DJI, you got three new robotics, Unique, Blade, which is made by Unique, even though that's an independent brand, not by Hearth and Hobbies. You got Event 38, you got Hudson, Freefly Systems. You got a mix there of that. Those are the sort of the top brands that people buy across all price points. The interesting thing about that, though, is that we calculate, so we did a calculation, I'm going to run out of time here. We think the average selling price is about $1,400. When you then go to make a prediction about forecasted volume of sales and dollar sales, how many billions of dollars our drone's going to generate, that's really where we start. But here's the real number. The real number for how many, what brands are used for commercial purposes. This comes from this sUAS news. Another $5. N numbers, that's the registered aircraft. Now that's the real number. That's the number of commercial drones that are being used, right? DJI is going to lead about 47%. Intended use, I've got two more slides, stay with me. Intended use, what did people buy their drone to do? Two separate things. People say, oh, well, this is a commercial drone. Really, what's a commercial drone? What is that? Define that term. Is it above $2,000, $5,000? Is it somebody you bought from a professional dealer? There's hardly no way to find that because people do two things. They buy drones and then they use them for some kind of purpose. Most purposes are for commercial, for photography and video. Half of that is hobby. Half of that is for commercial photography. Same thing, same deal. Once when they get a dollar for, when they get nothing for. We know that's not true, but for the sake of argument, let's just make that an argument. Okay? So, half of all drones are used just to do photography. Here's where it gets interesting, right? When you ask people their intended use, now you break it down and you go, well, tell me about your intended operations. If you are, in fact, doing some kind of civil or commercial work, or you're doing recreational or hobby or public governmental work. And 75%, what we found is 75% of all drones purchased over $2,000 end up with about 80%, that's the 75 here and the 10 here, for professional use, right? So the price of the drone can be correlated to it, but you have to think, a $2,000 drone, is that a prosumer drone or is that a commercial drone? It probably wasn't sold as a commercial drone, it was probably sold as a prosumer drone, right? But it ends up being used for commercial purposes or professional purposes. Okay, breaking it down. We broke it down, this chart will be available, you can pick up your slides, these are also on my slide share. Prosumer is a really narrow category. It's really only $1,000 to $2,000. Because what we did is we broke down the data and we said, well, you bought your drone at this price, what did you do with it? Well, we used it for hobby. And, or we used it for government or commercial use. So, right even at that $1,000 to $2,000 price range, still the majority are buying them for professional use. So there you have it. There's our category of drone usage and how we look at it at Skylogic Research. Questions?
There really are no questions because you gave away the secret on how to make money with drones, and that's charged.